They say that there are no pure accidents or coincidences in the universe, but that there is a guiding mind and hand. We call them God incidences. And maybe this is one such this evening. It happens to be the Feast of the Holy Name, and we have here probably the only one of these authentic holy faces which have come into this country and remained here. There were only 18 done at that miracle when it was displayed in Rome in the 1800s during that terrible period of disturbance when the Holy Father was afraid for Rome. And we have the miracle that took place, that it, as it were, came to life. So here we have a reminder, especially if one looks into the history of it, that it is linked with reparation. For what was going on politically there was the progressive exclusion of God from his rights in society, voting in laws which would chip away bit by bit at all that was Christian society, including the holy day of rest which the Lord had wanted for our good. Italy, like Ireland, has a bad track record with regard to abuse of the holy name, and in Italy they also have bad forms of the Madonna coming in, which is awful to hear. Unfortunately, in the area where we were, Tuscany, it wasn't nice, but they can misuse holy names, and they do. It's their maximum, and they go into it sometimes very easily, not realizing, as it were, the curses that they bring down in doing so. For to abuse a holy thing like that cannot do any good. It might make a point, but at what cost? And if one can't find a better way of making a point than drawing down that kind of demerit on one's head and soul, woe be the person. We need to be careful, because we might fall into some form of that ourselves, making a point by drawing God into it. Strangely enough, in school, our English teacher, who was also, as it happens, the religious education teacher, and therefore a practicing Christian, a Welshman, we used to call him Copperbonds because he had red hair. Good teacher, actually. But he, in English, in the English lesson, gave us this message. We were all boys, it was a boys' school. He was just giving us to understand that it's better, even on the human level, to have a rich vocabulary than to fall back on the vulgar and the divine. It's a lazy use of language, and he said so. You can see a cultured person by the amplitude of his lingua, what he can actually use in the form of playing on words, the unexpected word, the twist at the end of the sentence, the understatement, and so on. Far more powerful in even culture than just using God or vulgarity. So, there's some young people here, before we face life, let's get that one straight to start off with. It's worth it. It's culture, as well as anything else. By the way, we are judged on these things, if we're honest, because if we do speak well, without showing off or anything, one actually does tick a box, and people pick it up. If a person is always obliged to use that kind of language, that classes him straight away, so it's something to be aware of. I jump. With regard to what is going on in Ireland specifically, it's more of that. We know that the demon wants this last jewel in his crown. He's going to go to Poland afterwards. Now, just be aware that there's more going on than meets the eye. It's actually just the tip of the iceberg, but he hits hard there where there has been a bastion, where there has been grace. And one of the reasons why I was happy to come over to Ireland years ago was that I knew, going back a good few years now, that Ireland was a land where there was a density of grace. You come into this land, it's still there, but when I came in the early 90s, 1991, when I came earlier actually, 1986, it was dense. You felt, as soon as you got off the boat, this is different. There were churches everywhere, and they were prayed in. And it made a difference, because the norm was God. Why do we want more of the same thing Is it cool to be like everybody else and lose our culture and soul? It's a pity that we don't realize the damage that we're doing to ourselves. It's easy to undo, far more difficult to upbuild. But with regard to this, another thing actually, which people who come to visit me from Italy and so on, notice straight away, it's the amount of, wait for it, young people around. They're often coming from Italy. In your situation there, a child born in Italy, unless it's coming from Muslim parents, is going to have down the line the proportion of four old people to look after one child. That's the pattern. In Ireland, not just because of the travelling community, but that's a factor, but we do have a lot of babies, a lot compared with the rest of Europe. And it's something that right now we want to adjust to be like the rest of Europe. Therefore, it'll be a la mode to put them in the dustbin, because they're inconvenient, they're a nuisance. And actually, if we only realised the blessing of a child in re-establishing the correct dynamic of a family. You have a couple courting for years and years and years, and maybe getting down to marrying at the age of 39 to 40. They might just have one child who get all the attention, be spoiled, and be a heavy burden. You have a family which has lots of children. The couple is not looking at itself. It's natural healing, because as a team, they're coping with problems. But also, and I heard this actually from one of our novices, he had heaps and heaps of siblings, about 11 or so, and he was saying one time, it's actually not more work, because what happens is this, they become responsible, they're not selfish, and the big ones help the little ones, become little daddy and mammy at the age of 11. It's far healthier, and it's the way that things should be. It's a recipe for disaster to have a couple always analysing itself in their relationship, or having just one child, the centre of the universe, commanding the family. I just want to finish. There is a whole plethora of stuff to make reparation for right now that wasn't there before. One big one is the fact that this divine gaze, which it seems in that miraculous first showing that happened there in the 1800s, showed the pupils of the Lord gazing. That is something that is happening from the tabernacle, from the host, from the Mass itself, at all the ugly things that God sees in the souls and in the comportment, the physical behaviour of what's going on before Him. The very fact that we've made of our assemblies places of glorification, let's say of man, by applause and by all the rest of it, means that, in fact, God is insulted in the very act of worship. And not only that, but when, in worshipping God, we're still doing our own thing, e.g. disobeying, handling God badly under our own terms, who cares about confession, I have a right to communion, it's not good stuff. Multiply that by a nation, we've got a situation there of murky, murky church life, where actually people are no longer feeling what's going on. But God hasn't changed, nor have His angels. And our guardian angel can see it well. And the number of people who come to me complaining about hosts being found on the ground and all the rest of it is very upsetting. So it all matter for, yes, reparation. Let's think about that, and at least on our part, not add to the pain of our Lord. One, correct use of language. Two, correct use of the Lord's Day, in which we have that weekly rhythm of rest and repose and retreat that the Lord meant for our balance. And three, an awareness of the divine gaze when it comes to being in the presence of God, not talking in church, and receiving Jesus under His own terms and not ours.